Now, as always, for everybody that's new to the channel, I create these videos to help keep you updated on the latest developments in our community, as well as discuss technical topics so that we have a better understanding of how our engines work. So if you're interested in more videos like that, be sure to subscribe because there will be a lot more coming out in the future. Now let's get into the nitty-gritty, because there are a lot of different ways that a dyno can be wrong or just not really representative in order for you to compare dyno numbers with your friends and other people on the internet we want to argue with. A big one, of course, is calibration, because it is just a measurement tool, so it's only as accurate as it's set up to be. So if you want your measurements to be accurate, you have to calibrate it, and this applies to all dynos. Typically, the way this works is you set it up with a known figure, so something that it should be able to calculate. You see how far it's off and basically recenter it. So you give it a set amount of torque or something that it should be able to read. And if it's plus or minus, you know, 5 foot-pounds or whatever, you adjust it to the accurate number, and then it should be basically meeting that for a set period of time. Now, it's always going to drift. So over time, it's going to read slightly off, and it needs to be calibrated regularly. And if that calibration isn't done, or if it's done incorrectly, then the dyno will read wrong. Another thing is the setup, because again, it doesn't just need to be able to calculate torque, it also needs to be able to calculate RPM. And a really common way of doing that on a chassis dyno is driving your car up on the rollers and getting it up to a set speed and a certain gear and letting the car calculate the RPM for you. So for example, on my car, there's a period where you'll see the dyno operator is just kind of holding the RPM around 3000 RPM, and then they lock it in, they tell the car that's 3000 RPM in the gear you want to dyno, and it basically locks it in based on the wheel speed. It calculates the gear ratio and stuff like that. But if you get that wrong, if you tell the car it's at 3000 RPM, but really it's at 2900 or 3100, then you can run into issues where it won't calculate it properly. So you can even see in some of my dyno graphs, my red line is 7000 RPM, but it cuts off a little bit early. That's because the actual reading for the RPM was slightly off. And of course, as RPM rises, that percent error gets bigger. So now you see a bigger gap to the 7000 RPM mark that it should have been hitting before we hit fuel cut. But regardless, you know, again, it's just a representative number. It just tells you it's going to be really hard to get it perfect every single time. And the farther you are off from that accurate number, the more off your dyno numbers are going to be. Then, of course, there is the correction factor that we also like to argue about. And the point of a correction factor is because every dyno will give you an accurate number based on whatever your conditions are, but it also tries to give you a corrected number that you can use to compare with other people. And the point of the correction factor is it basically looks at the ambient conditions that you are dynoing in and tries to calculate what the power would be if you were at a set standard condition. So it looks at ambient pressure, ambient temperature, humidity, things like that. Kind of like when we look at density altitude and we say, oh, well, you've got a high DA or a low DA, and we know that that can affect your draggy times. It's the same thing with dyno numbers. So if you've got high ambient pressure or lower temperature, your numbers are going to be higher than if you have low ambient pressure or higher temperatures. And instead of having that variable as something that we're all talking about, the correction factor says, okay, at this set temperature and this set pressure and these set conditions, this is how much power you make. And everybody that uses that same correction factor should be able to compare all their numbers, and it'll be apples to apples. Now, of course, there are multiple correction factors. More of the common ones here in the United States are the standard correction factor, or SAE, but we also have other factors that other regions and countries use, and it really just depends. So there's not one set one that works for everybody. Now, in this sense, you can also manipulate your numbers, because that SAE correction is based on measurements from the room. So if you're not getting an accurate measurement of temperature, for example, let's say you heat up the probe that's telling you the temperature in the dyno room, it's going to put a bigger correction factor on your dyno numbers that inflates them higher than they should be. And the same for the opposite would be true. So if you cool down that probe so that it thinks it's cooler in the room, it's going to underrate your car and give you a lower corrected horsepower reading. So there are ways to manipulate it, although I don't see that. I've never seen that personally, but I've heard of it happening, and you know, I guess it's just something else to consider. Now, the last thing I want to talk about is why a lot of BMWs are underrated, especially in my case. If you guys have been around for a while, you saw my dyno video back in 2019 where I posted my 440i, comparing my stock tune compared to stage one, and I thought it was the perfect video because we had been arguing about dyno numbers for months since the boot mode tunes had come out, and we all kind of agreed, well, the most important thing is the delta, so we want to see before and after how much power it adds, and there wasn't a whole lot of attention being put on the number itself. So I was like, I can do that. I can put up the money, you know, pay for the time, get on the rollers and see how the car does. And I flashed between stock and stage one, posted the numbers, and immediately people started getting upset. I started getting comments about the dyno being too optimistic. There's no way my car makes that much to the wheels and, you know, yada, yada, yada. It was immediately an argument. Now, again, personally speaking, I find that dyno jets are the most representative of what our cars are doing. If you look at a lot of older cars like E46 M3s, E92 M3s, or just other platforms, you know, look at ZL1 Camaros or Mustangs or anything and look at their dyno figures, they generally read what you would quote unquote typically expect at the wheels, where they have probably close to 10 to 15% of drivetrain loss compared to their rated horsepower stock. So for me, I don't see dynojet as something that's overly optimistic. It's just that more recently, a lot of the turbo engines tend to report more torque and horsepower than what they were rated for. Whereas naturally aspirated engines typically report numbers that are more representative of what you would think. So where does that put us? I mean, in my opinion, I think the cars perform a lot better than they're typically expected to for the amount of horsepower and torque that they make. A lot of times when you race cars that are rated for the same amount of horsepower and torque, our cars are a lot faster. And it's not limited to BMWs. You see this a lot with Volkswagens, Porsches, Audis, you know, a lot of different brands, especially the turbo motors. It seems like the torque just carries better and reads higher on dyno jets compared to, you know, older naturally aspirated engines. So I know that's a point of contention again. I don't think that there's anything wrong with our cars being underrated. I think that our cars are really solid from the factory and they just continue to make more and more power as you feed them with more mods. So it's hard to really argue with that. So yeah, all of that to say, I'm a fan of wheel horsepower. I'm a fan of dyno jets. I do believe a lot of our modern cars are underrated. BMW even addressed that when we found some cars that were dynoing really high. They sent out software updates to nerf them down and make less power. So that sucked, BMW. Don't do that again. But otherwise, you know, it is what it is. The cars perform like we want, and there are plenty of mods to get you to reach your goals. So hopefully this answers all of the questions you guys have. I've just been doing a lot of research on dynos over the years, and that's kind of what brought me to my current position on which dynos I use and what I trust and why I've been sticking with what I know. Let me know your experience if you guys have had any other findings trying different dynos or different shops or even anything where you've used different dynos and tried to compare them. You know, where do you guys think you prefer your car to be dynoed and what kind of power are you making? So curious to see what you guys have to say. Other than that, I think that's it for this video. So thank you guys for watching and I hope this helps. And if you have any other questions or comments, leave them down below.